Greetings, dear friends. Welcome to Church in the Home. We're talking to a lot of people today who are sitting in homes, their home, some with guests that have come in, others with the regular group they have, to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm so glad that you tuned in today and pray that God's richest blessings be upon you. We're living in a very unusual and desperate time. It is times that I have felt led in my spirit need to be talked about. Everybody is a little confused over our world situation. This past week was introduced to us here in America the possibility that when ISIS gets through overcoming Iran and wherever he's working, his next step will be America. And the news came out later that he already is set up to invade America. Now, America has never been thought of as a place that could be invaded or could by any means be hurt. But the world has changed. It has radically changed. This new invader, whatever his name is, doesn't just invade a country, he kills everybody he can. He's not after a population, he's not after a group of people. He's in the process of killing who he can. He kills first those he hates. And it is a proven fact that his number one hatred is Christians. Christians. He takes babies out of Christian mothers' arms and saws them in two, cuts their head off. He wants it to be known that his God is greater than any other God. He will boast and say that his God is the same as ours. We just don't live for him. Latter part of that may be so. That's why I'm speaking on this subject today. But the fact is, the Muslim God is not our God. Has nothing to do with our Bible, except the hatred part probably started with Abraham ditching the mother of Muslimism out in the desert. They are still hateful and they still hate anybody that follows our God. How desperate could times become? When I saw the lineup of people this past week on television that was full mostly of mothers who were going to be shot or killed one way or another because they were Christians, I thought that's the world we live in. And I thought how desperate we are here in America. We don't feel safe in America anymore. We don't feel like we can just beat down an enemy anymore. The feeling has changed. Politicians have changed. They put off how desperate the situation is that they might make a little more money or have a little more power. So I want to talk to you today about the times we're living in. There's some of you that get this broadcast that live in times much worse than we have here in America. For you may already be under the direction of a dictator. Our dear friends in South Africa, not the country of South Africa, but in countries bordering South Africa, are still led by dictators. And we have groups there, believe it or not. And we pray for these that are in the groups in these places. We ask God to bless them and strengthen them and give them courage to go through whatever they must, because their future is in an ungodly, evil man's hands. And so if you're listening there today, and there's some that listen to every program, we ask that you trust God with us. My message today is not based on just those formal words of trust God. My message today is based on a radical fact that took place in the New Testament under the ministry of Paul the Apostle. His message was astoundingly different and outstanding in the area that believers did not live their own life anymore. So if I was to tell you here we need to brace ourselves about our life, I'd be mistaken. Because the life we now live is Christ. Paul says that 2 or 3 times. The life he now lived is Christ. So that means you can't give your life. What you do is all for Christ. Because the real you has been joined to your spirit, Christ in you. He that's joined to the Lord is one spirit. This is Christ in you and his workings. And the result of that is, it's his life you give. Not only in death, but in our daily living. This is why God's plan went into this area, that humans could not be trusted anymore to please God. The only one that pleased him was his son. And so he placed his son in us, in everyone who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. Not many who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ know anything about that. It was hidden for centuries and still hidden today in the Christian church even. But he's not hidden to us. That's not hidden to us. So all you can do is give Christ. And it is important that you know what you offer. It is entirely possible that these enemies that want to shut down America, they want to shut off America. You understand that? That's really what they want to do, is stomp America out of existence. But if Christ lives in us, they've got a harder job. They can't take our life without taking his. And I think about these who have been murdered already by godless men. Were their lives offered in vain? They may know Christ to the extent that they call themselves Christians, but did they know the Lord to the extent that the life they lived was not their own? It was Christ. So there's a whole greater truth facing us. I see people who take the Christ life nonchalantly. First group, it was Pentecostal. Oh, yeah, I've always known Jesus was in me. I haven't the slightest idea what they're talking about. Just an emotion. We have another group of people who have bordered Paul's message, but have decided that it wasn't for us today. That's sad, too, because the world needs to hear this message of the Apostle Paul. Not only that, there are people who have heard it and have turned it down. They don't wish to give Christ to a lost world, to a dying world. They wish to do their own thing, start their own religion. I've had several in this fellowship through the years, 40 years I've been in it now, that heard a little bit of the message and wanted to add what they already knew to it, and so they did. They just added what they thought to it, and the end result was they really had nothing. They really had nothing. So there's a question you and I have to face today. If Christ lives in us, how does that affect our lives in this world? How does it? What difference does it make? I was reading scripture just yesterday where Paul said that neither mama or daddy will must interfere with this relationship with Christ. Neither son or daughter must interfere. Why? Because when we go to glory, our family will not be a group. We'll not be like we are down here. You'll know each other, but not on the same basis. So the issue really is, what are you going to do with Christ in you? There have been thousands of people who have heard me speak around the world about Christ living in the believer as the believer's life. Many of them turned it down. Many of them listened to their own preachers. We'll talk about that in a moment. But I just wanted you to know that my heart is burdened. I'm stirred. I believe God has given to us the message that must be given to the world. People who enter the darkness that's in this world now need the light of Christ in them. They don't need to say, I'm just walking with Jesus. I'm doing all I know to do. They need to know what the Scripture says, that they no longer live. Christ lives in them. If they don't awaken to that, the world will not have the message. So I don't know if Christians in the rest of the world that are being killed are dying because their name is Christian. Maybe some. I don't know if those who claim to be Christian are true Christians who, with Paul, would give their life to anybody for God's glory. I don't know if any of them know Christ lives in them. And that's sad. And I'll tell you why that's sad. If you and I face the world ahead, Christ in you will be your hope of glory. You won't have any other hope. Church buildings give you no hope. Preachers will give you no hope. If they don't know the Christ life message, they can give you no hope. They can tell you to pray. They can tell you to fast. They can tell you to be alive by your own doings. But our own doings will make no difference in the world to come. We must have one greater doing through us than we ourselves doing something. Take your Bible, if you will, and turn to 2 Timothy. Our glorious leader, the Apostle Paul. And you say, well, why is he our glorious leader? Because he is the only apostle that belongs to the born again. No other apostle in the Scriptures belong to the born again. He's our glorious leader because he was made an apostle for this dispensation. He will only exist in this dispensation of grace. That's enough for leadership. He didn't have an easy life. And we're going to talk a little bit about an uneasy life today. Because people say to me, well, why aren't you telling us how to have faith, how to rebuke the devil, how to overcome this world? Because that isn't the message. The message is, what are you going to do with the Christ who lives within you? See, that's a radical change. That's a radical change. What are you going to do with this Jesus? God's not going to knock down all the walls. He's not going to give us seas to walk across on dry ground. He's not going to slay all the enemy. Then what is he going to do? He took his most priceless possession and placed it in every born-again believer. What are you going to do with it? How's that going to affect you? Because you see, our hope isn't in the Lord coming and delivering us. Our hope is Christ already is our life. He lives in us. He doesn't have to come to us to defend us. All he needs is for us to give him a mind so that he can operate according to his own will. We're far from that. We state it, we preach on it, but we're a long way from it because that hasn't reached the audience, least here in America, like I'd like to see it. I walk around with Christ in me. I think he's not walking with me. He's walking in me. I get up in the morning and I think, Lord, make this a good day. I forgot. Lord, this is your day. This is your day. Can I have a bad day with you? It's the recognition of Jesus Christ as our life. 2 Timothy in chapter 4, 2 Timothy 4, I want to begin reading at the third verse. It says, for the time will come, they will not endure sound doctrine. Now let's talk about that line. They will not endure sound doctrine. Who are the people that are to stand up for Jesus? Who are the people that should be willing to lay down their life? They are the people whom Paul says have not accepted or received the true gospel. Now, they can go to any church. They can sit on anybody's ministry. And that still could be said of them. Because ultimately and finally, it isn't what the preacher says. It isn't the denominational doctrines. Eventually, it's going to be what this book says. What the Word says. I was listening to a preacher this past week. He's a good preacher. I loved him. Loved to hear him preach. But he picked out several doctrines that were heartbeats for me. For instance, he talked about the four or five times in 1 John where it says we're born again, those who are birthed by God. He read the middle of the verse. He read the last line of the verse. But he did not read the first line that said, we are birthed by God. What is going on? Just what this line says. They will not endure sound doctrine because sound doctrine is not preached and ministered today. Very few talk about it. It's up to you and I to know the scriptures, to know what the Word says, to know what God's intention is. I can't get that word out of my mind because more and more, almost every day I serve the Lord, I see God's intention working, not what he's doing necessarily, but his intention. What he intended is going to work. He intended for Christ to die on the cross and bear the sin of humanity. He intended that. He's done that. But there are many other things he intends to happen. Maybe it is a bad, dark world that he intends. We have to be ready for it. Let's read on in verse 3. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. I don't know how you feel about a line like that. I couldn't attend the average mega church today because they obviously have put words into their messages that give itching ears to the people. Better preachers than I, greater men than I, but there are those that hide the gospel from the people who need it. So when the time comes, you're going to find a lot of people claiming to be Christian who have no value. In fact, our present president, and one of the first speeches he made was, "I'm a Christian." And he alluded to the fact that he was Baptist. That doesn't count anymore. And so what we have to do is to be careful about who we listen to. If you don't like somebody you're listening to, take your Bible. Take it to bed with you. Read some of it when you get up in the morning. Got a break in the day. Read some more of it. Stick with Paul. Because he knows what bad times are. He knows what hard times are. But let's read on in these verses. It says, "But after their own lust, they will heap to themselves teachers having itching ears." Itching ears. My wife's a good listener to somebody. She listens to people who have the grandest, greatest congregations, and she listens for what they say. And many times, that preacher will never say the word Jesus Christ. How could you preach the Word of God, preach the gospel, or preach as a religious person and not mention Jesus Christ? Is that possible when he's God's all in all, when he's God's everything? Go into the fourth verse. "And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables." Well, that's happening. Verse 5. "But watch thou in all things." This is why I'm talking to you like this today. Be careful now. "Watch thou in all things. Endure afflictions." You're going to have them. "Do the work of an evangelist." You're going to be one. Some of you have never been caught in a place where you had to do evangelistic work, but the day is coming. Maybe you're arrested for being a Christian. Do you know enough of the word to be an evangelist? Because I promise you, you're going to start preaching the truth. You're caught. May not be any way out. Verse 5 says, "Make full proof of thy ministry." Now, why does he talk like this? What's his purpose in this kind of talk? The next line of verse 6 tells us, "For I am now ready to be offered." I am now ready to be killed. Or he could have said, "I'm now ready to have my head chopped off." Heads chopped off. This was 2,000 years ago Paul made these statements. Did you know this past week any number of people had their heads chopped off? We had two notable Americans that had their heads chopped off. He says, "I'm ready." Stamp that in your mind. Are you ready? Are you ready? I'm not asking you what you know. I'm really talking to you today about who you know. I'm not talking to you about the God that can do anything and then he'll just perform miracles here and there. I'm talking to you about God who wants one thing, and that's you to be his son and his daughter. Wow, that's different. That's what the cross is all about. Cross is not God becoming greater so that he could do greater things. The cross was that if Christ lives in believers, they, with Christ in them, do these great things. He says, "I'm ready to be offered. And the time of my departure is at hand." Are you ready for anything to happen? Are you ready? We don't even think in America, why shouldn't I be ready? Why shouldn't I? The new world order can take over America in certain places instantly. Why? Because we have Muslims everywhere in America. They may be like believers. They will return to their religion and do what their government says. Mark my word, we are not just living in little places where we cannot be touched or hurt or have anything to happen to us. He's ready. I want you, again, I say, stamp that in your mind. You better get ready. If it doesn't happen, you haven't wasted time. Because whether in your lifetime or the lifetime of your grandchildren, evil is going to appear. Evil is going to do its best. The devil will do his best to make his last and final fight in America, and he will deceive millions in that attempt. Be ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. Now, I can't say that. I have a feeling that makes me want to talk like I'm talking today, but I can't say that I'm going to have this to happen, that it's going to take place. That Paul knew it. He knew by the Holy Spirit that his day was up, his time was finished, and he was ready to be offered. So he says, the time of my departure is at hand. How you like that? How you like that? You're not going to die, you're going to depart. Get death out of your mind. Get to thinking about who you are. I'm a never die person. They may take this body of mine, put it in a hole, but they can never take the real me, joined to Christ. So some of you are going to depart. That's been one of the hardest things for me to handle in the last 10, 15 years in the Christ life, because so many of my dear friends who worked hard to build this message up in their areas died. So I don't look at them as people who died now. I'll join with Paul and say they just departed because they're going to be with the Lord. Going to be with the Lord. You say, well, is that instantly? Instantly? Yep. You know how it's instant? When you die and the preacher says you've gone to be with the Lord, your last breath on this earth and your next breath will only seem like a second. 5 seconds, 10 seconds. The people who lay in the graves, when they are resurrected, will only have been there a moment. You see, we don't understand this departure business. Departure means you're going somewhere. We lived on this earth to please the Lord, to be His servants. When we die, to the Lord, there'll only be a few seconds between that death and the resurrection morning. Here we are alive and we know all these things, and we daily pray, hurry up, Lord Jesus, come. If you die, it'll be an instant. Who can do that? Only the Lord can do that. And He'll do that for His offsprings, His children. My departure is at hand. Verse 7 says, I fought a good fight, I finished my course, and I've kept the faith. You have these things working in your life? Simple is my message. Are these things working in your life? Because that has to do with the Christ that's within you. I kept the faith, finished my course, had a good fight. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but to all them also that love his appearing. A big percentage of Christians don't believe in the rapture. Many of them after the tribulation period. Many of them during the tribulation period. They're mixed up. If they listen to Paul, it's all stated like I think it'll be. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Just in a moment. We hate to see somebody pass. One of the most faithful persons we've ever had in this fellowship was a dear brother that lived in northern Arkansas. He married a Japanese woman, I think it was. He wasn't out and about a lot. They didn't travel. He came to one or two camp meetings. Unknown. Nobody understood him. He died this past month. But he was faithful to the end. How was he faithful? He was faithful in his prayers for this fellowship. He loved this fellowship. He was faithful in what it was we were doing. For he knew that if we weren't doing it, he knew no one else that was. And there are many others. He just didn't know it. But he lived in the hope that we were doing a good thing. Then we have Millett, George Millett. He fought a great fight in Portland, Oregon. We had a grand group of people there. I went there every month for well over 20 years. God took him home. He's with the Lord now, or he will be. On the resurrection morning, his whole being as a being will be translated. Meet the Lord in the air. He'll be waiting in the air when I'm coming up. Hard to take all these things, but I wanted you to get braced. You understand, some of you understand this already. You're not as old as I am, but you understand this already, that the older you get, the more you lose your friends, your loved ones. You're aware of that, aren't you? They finally are called home. 8th verse says, henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me in that day, and not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing. Enough of his good words. Think about the Apostle Paul, our leader. Did he not leave a message about going to meet the Lord? Did I not read those verses in Timothy when he talked to Timothy? Were they not fully stated of what happens when we go to meet the Lord? Let's not talk about death anymore. We don't like death. I was thinking this past week about believers. They don't like death. But did you know that death was one of the most important aspects of the Christ life? That's why Paul is always talking about the believer being dead, dying daily. Why does he say that? Because our death is to ourselves. That's the big death we die, is to ourselves. Would you like to know why Christianity has not changed our world? Many places it's done great. But most of this world still doesn't know Jesus Christ by Christianity. You know why? It's because the believer never entered into his death. This is another message. But this is where Paul speaks about death. That the believer must be dead. To what? To self. How can Christ come to live in you if you're not dead to yourself? How can Christ be your Lord if you don't get under subjection who you are and what you are? I'm talking about Christ in you. Do you really believe Christ lives in you? Do you really believe that? I want you to turn with me to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Verse 35. When you got saved, God put Christ in you. He made an exchange between you and Christ. But because we have not died to ourselves and to our works, and to our thinking about who we are, if you haven't died to that, how in the world can the Christ who lives in you matter? How can he matter? Verse 35. Romans 8 and 35. Paul says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Who? Who can do that? Why? There isn't anybody that can separate you from the love of Christ. And he enumerates some of these people. Shall tribulation? I hope none of you go through the tribulation. That would be a great sorrow if I knew it to me. That you went into the tribulation. You wasn't caught up to meet Jesus in the air. You had made a farce out of religion in your attempt to be a Christian. You didn't mean it. That would be awful. Who shall separate you from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation? Somebody came to me this past week and said, are we living in the tribulation period now? Oh, I said no. We're having the Lord speak and say that there will be tribulation at the end. And did not Jesus say that when he was on earth? Tribulation is going to come. But tribulation can't separate you from Christ. Distress cannot separate you from Christ. Persecution cannot separate you from Christ. If you don't get bread to eat, you go into a famine, it cannot separate you from Christ. You can get to where you have no clothes to wear, you're naked, but it can't separate you from Christ. Peril or sword cannot separate you from Christ. Why did he name off these things? Because the Christ that lives in you is there by a love affair. You understand that? It's a love affair going on between you and the Lord. If you don't love him, if you mistreat him, if you break away and do yourself thing, become yourself, you've mistreated Christ. You don't really love him. That happens to the majority of Christians, I think. Unless this gospel is preached, they'll not know the difference. Then he says in verse 36, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. Killed. What does that mean? That means that things happen in your life that look insurmountable, but they're not. That means that the things that happen in your life separate you from Christ, and you grumble and gripe. I knew a fellow that cursed every time something went bad, and on other days he talked in tongues. He was a mixed-up instrument. But you know what? Nothing can separate us. Let's read on here. I say Romans. Oh, yeah. He got it right in front of me. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. We. You say, I can't understand that. Well, I couldn't either if I didn't know Christ lived in me. Listen to me closely now. That's the language of one who has Christ living in them and knows it. The rest of their body, their life, their mind may be counted for slaughter. But the real them, the real person in Christ cannot be killed. Mark that verse. Let's look at it again closely. As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Somebody may take part of you, but they can't take all of you. Some things may happen in your mind and in your soul. But what happens in your spirit can never be taken away from you. That's where Jesus lives. He doesn't live in your squirmish soul where you're good one day and bad the next. But you're in the process. You're in the process of being brought under subjection to the Christ who lives in you. That's not an easy thing. It's something I must preach regularly. I must not let you leave this room without the knowledge that Christ lives in you. That's my responsibility. I cannot be a part of the gospel. They will say, oh, we had a great service. Everybody was blessed. I've got every time I get before you, do what Romans 16:25 says. I must preach this Christ who lives in believers. But let's read on. Verse 37 says, nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. He's brought out a very important factor here, that it is Christ's love that engenders a people. It's Christ's love that holds them together. He loves you. He loves you. I'm reminded of that in many different ways, and I'd like for you to take hold of how you are reminded of how much he loves you. I go into the average home and I see a picture on the wall of Christ dying on the cross. My first thought is not that he died on the cross, but that I was in him when he died. That's him dying that I might have life and have it more abundantly. So it's a question of how you think as to what Christ means to you. He loves us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in, circle that little in, in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is what we preach. This is what we believe. This is what our endeavor is at this time, in this place. Go with me to 1 Corinthians 4. First Corinthians 4. Verse 9. How should your thoughts be? You're not apostles, but this is the way Paul teaches apostles to live. Verse 9. For I think that God has set forth us, the apostles, last. They don't get the first fruits and the blessings of the message. They are set aside last. Why? As it were appointed to death. For we are made a spectacle unto the world, and to angels, and to men. Advice he's given to apostles. Verse 10 says, we are fools for Christ's sake. But those of you listening to him say we are wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are honorable, but we are despised. Under this present hour, we both hunger and thirst and are naked and are buffeted and have no certain dwelling place. That's how apostles looked at themselves. You think, oh, they walked around with the mighty power of God. Let me say something. After the cross, there is no emphasis put by any New Testament writer, but especially none by Paul, that you're going to have great signs, wonders, and miracles. Not one time. I read this, I think, in the last sermon or two. They're not mentioned anymore in the New Testament. They're mentioned by Jesus of Nazareth. That's his ministry. They're mentioned in the Old Testament, but they're not mentioned in grace. Why are not signs, wonders, and miracles mentioned in grace? Because Christ lives in you. What other need could you possibly have? Ah, you see, we don't know very much about this Christ that lives in us. We haven't taken him to heart yet. It's not really real to us. But it is a good thing to be reminded of these things. In the fourth chapter of 1 Corinthians, let's read all of the ninth verse. For I think that God has set forth us apostles to be last, as it were appointed to death, for we are made a spectacle unto the world, unto angels, and to men. You have any thinking along that line about yourself? We are fools for Christ's sake, but you are wise in Christ. He lists off the fact that we who preach this message must be given to the Christ who is the theme of this message. Verse 11 says, unto the present hour we both hunger and thirst and are naked and are buffeted and have no certain dwelling place. We labor working with our own hands, being reviled. We bless, being persecuted, we suffer it. Being defamed, we entreat. We are made as filth of the world and are the offscouring of all things to this day. Paul says, I write not these things to shame you, but as my beloved sons, I warn you. For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, you have not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. What do you need most? What's your big need here today? You need money? You need healing? You need blessings you can shout over? Listen to what he says. I write these things not to shame you, but as my beloved sons, I warn you. For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have ye not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus, I have begotten you through the gospel. Why do I pick on those who don't preach the gospel? Why do I have remarks to make about preachers who are great successes, preach to thousands of people? Why do I remark about it? If they do not preach Paul's gospel, they are erring. Romans 16:25. If when they get in the pulpit, they don't have it in their mind that I preach this gospel that will enable people to live for God. So it is in our ministry. I intend to awaken you to think today, to place your mind on this sort of thing. How many instructors are you listening to? How many people do you listen to about truth? How many people recognize they are dying as they preach? Listen to me now. It's an important thought. I have had any number of people in this fellowship who took to the message, who could speak it some better than I, but they didn't preach the gospel. They kept adding the things to it that were important to them. They didn't preach Paul's gospel. And you know what the end result was? They came to nothing. What they said was not so, was not truth, was not Paul's gospel. And he makes it very clear here that the preaching of the gospel is an important factor. I was looking through some of my past messages. I have hundreds of them. But I was looking through them, and there was a great number of those messages that had the word gospel in its title. I believed in the gospel that Paul gives us. I believed that the only one in the Bible that had the final gospel was the Apostle Paul. I believed that the Apostle Paul received the gospel he was to preach directly from Jesus Christ, came by revelation. I believe that. If I believe that, then you don't need some other gospel. You don't need to know something else. You don't need to go somewhere else. You need to know what Paul says. What Paul says. It's that important. I want you to go to 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter. Second Corinthians, chapter 4, and we'll talk a little bit more about Paul's hard times. Begin in verse 8. He says, we're troubled on every side. You know, here in America, we don't pay much attention to a line like that in the scriptures. But in America, I don't know a family that doesn't have trouble in the family. It has been a sad thing. I can remember a day when I was a much younger preacher where a whole family could stand together and fight together and believe together. But I hardly know a family today that doesn't have problems. That's what he means when he says on every side. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus. That the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our bodies. In our bodies. One of the greatest missionaries we've ever had in Christendom was on a talk show, television talk show, one time. And on that talk show, the moderator finally came to the point of asking him about Christ. What about Jesus who lives in you? Does he do anything? Does he have any help? He says, do you have a great faith for Jesus? Is your faith greater than most others? And he said this, right out of this scripture. The last line of verse 11. He said, the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in my mortal flesh. Have you come that far yet? Are you interested in that yet? This man happened to believe the in Christ message. What was he basing his relationship to God on? He was basing that relationship very simply on Christ in him. I want you to leave this meeting thinking, Christ, if you do live in me, please correct my mind. Correct my mind. Somebody says, I have no feeling for it. You won't get any feeling. He'll just become you. As you die, he becomes you. As you die to self, to your own ideas, he comes through you. That's Christ. And I've come to the end of what I have to say. God bless every one of you, and may this message stir you a little or much. God bless you till we meet again.